All set. So let us now, for the sake as we are teachers, this is not something that you need to teach the students immediately, but since this is a teaching workshop, let us try to look at what this, you know, I'm coming every day and telling recursive definition, etc., etc. And I know that jokes will start getting cracked on that. So that you remember, you know, you'll always remember me for a recursive definition. So what does this recursive definition look like? The recursive definition, I'll show a very simple form, and then we'll start looking at what it looks like. To get an idea of the variations that can happen, and what are the types of recursive definitions we are looking at for our problem solving. So our function is fx. And it has some, for the time being I'm using only one, it has some basis condition and some basis function is evaluated. Correct? Otherwise, how does it look like? It has got a set of sub-problems are defined. So, you have g1x, g2x, up to gmx. And then, the results of this which comes back, there is some other function which operates on them. So we call that function the W function. I'm taking a very simple form because there may be multiple basis conditions and there may be multiple recursive conditions. But this is the simplest form that we are looking at. Now let us see the different problems that we have done. Let us see finding numbers. Here, other than the basis condition which was the one, so these are called the decomposition functions. And this is called the recomposition function. So, split one, split two, or split was the decomposition function for finding the maximum of n numbers, and W was max. When we wanted to find the maximum of n numbers, the decomposition function was splitting and the recomposition function was max. Correct? When we wanted to do merge sort, then the decomposition function was splitting and the recomposition function was merging. When we wanted to do quick sort, the decomposition function was partitioning, So though I have written multiple decomposition functions, there could be only one of them also. And each one of them can give multiple outputs as results. I'm not going to details of parameterization. I'm only discussing this conceptually. And what was the recomposition function? Concatenation. Concat was the recomposition function. Similarly, when we went into Fibonacci, the decomposition function was what? One was n minus 1, one was n minus 2. And the recomposition function was add plus 1. That was the recomposition function. And you had some other examples which we saw. Here, here again, the recomposition function, as you can see here, is a little more complicated. And you have these decomposition functions, and the recomposition function is a little more complicated. It got even a little more complicated in this one, where this is the matrix chain multiplication, where there is two parts to this, this. These were added, and this was taken, and many such for various k's it was formed, and then a minimum was taken. So this was a little more complicated than this structure that we see here. But essentially, you will break it up into a set of functions, and then you will recompose it. That is the idea that we have. So now, let us look at some scenarios. Which will help us understand what we are trying to do. So suppose we have a node and we decompose it into three parts, then this decomposes, then this decomposes, then this decomposes, then this becomes basis condition. Say this is basis condition. These double-edged marks are all basis conditions. And after that, the recursion, after that this is computed, based on these two this is computed, based on these two this is computed, etc., etc. And we have seen many kinds of decomposition and recomposition functions. If we list the recomposition functions that we have seen, we have seen min, we have seen plus, we have seen merge, we have seen concat, min or max, and we have seen variety of functions. And these functions tell us what we can do when we get to the final algorithm. So typically, if we look at it in terms of computation here, then it will come here, and if we unfold this back this side, so this is the decomposition as it goes down, and this is the recomposition as it happens. Right? So the black one is the decomposition and the orange one is the recomposition. Now let us look at the recomposition function a little carefully. If the recomposition function is min or max, what is the property of min-max? Right. What else is the property of the functions min and max? It is associative. It is commutative. Correct? So, because, listen very carefully, because it is associative and commutative, if the results are at the leaves, normally the results are propagated up, but in many cases I can propagate the results to the leaves along the recursion. So suppose I know the result at the leaf, then whichever order I combine it by, I will get the correct result, because it is min or max. That means I could do this followed by this, followed by this, followed by this, followed by this, and so on. Or I could do this followed by this, followed by this, followed by this. I could recombine any one of them in any order. I could do the same thing with plus. But I cannot do the same thing with merge. Merge is associative, but not commutative. Merge is associative, but not commutative. Concat is associative, but not commutative. Are we okay up to this point? So this tells us something more. So this tells us that my evaluation, if I look at it, is actually a traversal of the recursion tree. My evaluation is a traversal of the recursion tree. And if it is associative, then, but not commutative, then I cannot traverse the recursion. See, normally we all think that we are supposed to traverse the tree like this. Nobody has told us we have to traverse the tree like this. I could traverse this path. I could traverse this path. I could then traverse this path. I could do whatever I like, but I must maintain the property of the recombining or the recombination operator. Which means that when I evaluate this and develop my final algorithm, are you all with me? If I evaluate and develop my final algorithm, it is actually a traversal of this tree, recursion tree, in some order. And I don't have to traverse it this way. Secondly, some solutions are saying that the recombination operator, if it is plus, then it says that you have to evaluate all the subproblems. You have to. Otherwise, you won't be able to get the correct value. If you are identifying duplicates, it's fine. but you still have to evaluate all the sub-problems. But if it is min or max, you need not. If it is or, you need not. For example, if a solution tells you that you will return if something exists. So if any solution gives you exists, the other parts you don't need to do. You can simply terminate the algorithm there. So another important thing that we have to remember is that some of the recombination operators are of what we called the OR type. That means you don't necessarily need, if you can, there may be possibilities of evaluating the solution without looking at all the children. There could be. For example, finding in an unordered list. We split it into two parts. As soon as we find the solution, we stop. We don't need to look at the other part. You're finding in an unordered list. You're finding an element. Our algorithm is split it into two parts. Look at this list, find the OR. The OR is an OR operator. If any one of them, you get it. The others you don't need to do. You can simply terminate. On the other hand, plus, merge, concatenate, these are all AND operators. These are all AND operators. So the properties of this recursion tree, the properties of the decomposition and the recomposition functions, and the case of memorization of identical subproblems and any other data structures is what the final algorithm actually is. The final algorithm eventually is a traversal of this tree. And nobody has told you that you have to traverse it like this. That is because our programming languages tell us that way. Our programming languages are like that. I could do this one first, then I could do these two, then I could do this, then I could do this, then I could do this. So I could do it in any order. And I would like to do it in an order which is most suitable for me. So the optimal ordered traversal of the recursion tree utilizing its decomposition and recomposition properties is what ends up in the final algorithm. And then, you know, it streamlines to a program is all right. But eventually your algorithm is an intelligent traversal of that recursion tree. There are several other nuances to this. There are several other properties of this. I don't want to discuss that now, but I just want to highlight that the crux of the problem, the crux of algorithm design is here. We want to traverse this tree as minimally as possible and find the solution. Got it? So that is what it all leads to. When you do a depth-first traversal of the tree, you call it backtracking. But backtracking is much bigger than that. Backtracking, for us, all of us, backtracking is like this. Backtracking firstly tells you where to backtrack. Why do you have to backtrack to the parent? You will backtrack to the next most eligible node which you think will help you find the solution. So, eventually, what is the algorithm? Then we'll come to, you know, what is there in the standard books. But what is the algorithm? So what is finally the algorithm? The algorithm starts with a list L, which is your original node fx. Then it removes this fx from that list L and puts it in another list called Y. Z. And using the decomposition operators creates the children for this node and maintains pointers back to this node, identifying what is the recombination operator that you have to do. And then again, from this list L, picks out another child. Which child? That is depending on you. That is depending on how I want to run the algorithm. Are you with me? And this is how it goes on. At certain points in time, it decides to use the recombination operator and recalculate the solution. It could calculate the solution on the fly. It could also calculate the solution at the end. This is the essence of the algorithm. The essence of the algorithm is an intelligent traversal of the recursion tree with appropriate knowledge of the decomposition and recomposition operators. So algorithm, the derivation of algorithm, is actually the traversal of the recursion tree. So again, to get down to reality, you know, whenever we discuss this, it is always important to get down to some problems, show how it works, again go back to the theory. Again get down to the problem, show how it works, again go back to, if you put too much of theory, people will not understand anything. Let us look at this n queens placement problem. How do we define it recursively? You all know the n queens placement in a chessboard. How do we define it recursively? You define, for every row, we all know that a queen can be placed in only one row. So for every row, we take a slot, correct? And the queen could be, for every row, the possibilities of the queen are 1 to n. If there are n rows, then it can be any 1 to n. And then we have constraints. So how will I generate children? From nothing, it can be in any one of the columns of the first row. And then I recursively call it from there. And what is my recomposition operator? Or, because if I get stuck somewhere, I will return failure. And if I succeed, so if I fail anywhere, I will return 0. If I succeed somewhere at the end, I will return 1. And my recomposition operator is OR. So now, the n queens placement problem is actually a traversal of this tree. And you don't need to traverse all nodes. Because as soon as you get a solution, you can stop. So all these problems, which are told to be backtracking type, are typically mapped into a framework which is like this. They define n variables. V1, V2, to Vn. And each variable can take a value. So each variable vi can take a value from a set vi1 to vi ki. So there are certain variables or slots, and for each slot there is a set of potential values, maybe finite, maybe infinite, whatever. And there are certain constraints amongst the values, amongst the variables, that if this variable takes this variable cannot take this value. If that variable takes this value, then that variable cannot take certain values. So between the variables, there is a value constraint relationship. It may be pairwise relationship, or it can be multiple relationships. So this is the general framework for a large number of problems which fall in the backtracking category, quote unquote, textbook backtrack algorithm. And typically, they end up or. Any one you find a solution? Or sometimes they tell you that there is a cost associated and you find the minimum or maximum. So these problems fall into the category of what is known as, can anybody tell me? Yeah, the constraint satisfaction problem. Or they may also be that is a more general category, but for us another famous problem of the constraint satisfaction category which involves backtracking is crossword puzzle. The crossword puzzle. You have rows and columns which are numbered, and you have a query on them, and then you have a set of possible solutions on them, and those which intersect, they satisfy certain constraints. So you can develop a recursive definition for any of these problems, but you will see that they typically fall in the category of a set of variables, each having a set of potential values, and there are constraints between these variables and values, and you are to assign a set of values to these variables such that all constraints are satisfied. So among the, so now we are going to traversal. The easy traversals we have seen, you need to traverse everywhere. You need to see all the solutions, etc. Here, the traversal becomes a little more complicated. We have seen the spanning tree already. We'll see some more problems. And we'll see how we can derive some of these problems from there. So they are typically of the constraint satisfaction or constraint optimization nature. That leads us to most of the algorithms which are related to either greedy or backtracking or branch and bound. The divide and conquer we have discussed. Okay. Dynamic programming we have discussed. And then we will see how all of them combine in various forms to produce the algorithms which are famous. The crossword puzzle is also a constraint satisfaction problem. Now, for these algorithms, which are of the constraint satisfaction type, these problems which are of the constraint satisfaction type, so at any point in time, the problem, the algorithm that solves these problems is of this nature. So as I said, typically the algorithm is a traversal of the tree. But for most of the constraint satisfaction problems, you will conceptualize the variables as these boxes, is these circles, the constraints among these variables as edges. There may be three variable constraint also, which I'm not drawing. And for every variable, you'll have a potential value set. Your objective is to choose one value from each set such that the constraints are all satisfied. This is how the crossword puzzle works. This is how the N queens works. This is how the traveling salesman problem works. All of them work like that. You have to associate a value. For the time being, I'm talking only of the constraint satisfaction, not the optimization problems. And therefore, your algorithm now proceeds this way. It chooses a variable, chooses a value, assigns it, then chooses another variable, tries to choose a value, assigns it, and see if it satisfies. Otherwise, it chooses another one. So the order in which you choose the values, variables, and the order in which you start choosing the values determines your algorithm, which is identical to what I said. Who told you have to traverse the tree in a particular way? You can traverse the tree in any intelligent order that you want to. Therefore, if we are looking at a mechanism where the problem will just be described to us as the recursive definition, our holy grail is to be able to just read this in and produce a algorithm. Whether you understand it or not is immaterial. But that is the most efficient way to solve this problem. That is the goal. The other goal obviously is to try to make it understandable, try to remove all the flurries of it and make it look like an algorithm. But it need not look like an algorithm that we see in the textbook. So among the methods that we will have to discuss, and I will ask you all to go and read this in a little more details, is this constraint satisfaction problems and the methods that are employed in the constraint satisfaction problems. The methods that are employed are very famous methods of backtracking schemes. They are called look ahead. You assign some things and then you try to see if there are any other variables whose values exist. For example, I may put a, when you do the N queens, you may put few of them in such a way, a particular row may have nothing to be put there, which means that its value set becomes empty. Its value set becomes empty. So, look ahead is one of the techniques that are used, and I will ask you to go through this. I'm not going to go through this now. We will leave all these for the final, when we do it in May, then we will discuss this in more details. But I want you all to have a detailed look, and the people who will come prepared for it, to have a look at these schemes. Then there is this variable ordering, which variable I will take and which value I will put. Which variable I will take. For example, in the n queens problem, as soon as in the first row, if you put the queen in the first row, first column, then for all other rows, the diagonal element, those values should get removed from their list. All this should get removed from the list if we choose that value. So one approach is not to decide which value to choose, but to decide which value not to choose. To decide which value not to choose. So we, based on this, we order the variables, we order the values, and we do these four things: look ahead, variable ordering, and constraint propagation. You will find the details of constraint satisfaction problems mainly in books of AI. How many of you have taught AI? It is there, no? Constraint satisfaction problem. You'll find them in books of AI. They are the most well-studied backtracking type of schemes. How to backtrack, where to backtrack, when to backtrack. And that is fundamental to our understanding of the algorithm design. Our understanding of algorithm design will come from there. A large class of problems will be solved by the techniques available there. So now let us come to a new problem called the stamps problem. So the stamps problem is defined as follows. You are given a set of stamp denominations. So you are given a set of set S of stamp denominations, S1, S2 to SN. And you are given a value C. Your first problem is to find a set of stamps whose value is equal to C. That means we want to find a set of stamps whose value is equal to C. Whether you call it the stamp selection or the coin selection or whatever. Now, first step, how will you solve this problem? The second is to do it with minimum number of stamps. How will you solve this problem? Yeah, it is the subset sum problem. No, I have only one mantra: write a recursive definition.
For solving this problem, we just draw a tree, and in one edge we include the values, and in another edge we exclude.
So write down the recursive definition, all of you.
Yes.
Write down the recursive definition. If we are to find, there are various ways of looking at the problem, but the most general problem, write down the recursive definition. He has gone to sleep already. Gone. Yes. No, I don't understand. When all of India sits down somewhere, this yes and no is very difficult to understand. Yes, no, yes, no. I cannot figure out. Gone to sleep or not? No. Do it. So what is the way of doing it? The inclusion-exclusion principle. The inclusion-exclusion principle. You know what are the problems you should do in class? You should do reasonably easy problems in class so that you can give the problem to people. You should give problems to people which are not very easy because they will know everything. Little difficult, but not too difficult. Because if it is too difficult, they will come with solution. You also won't know what to do. And the question should be given depending on how intelligent people are in the class. You have all AIR 1 to AIR 10 in the class, be very careful. You will give one problem, he will give you two problems back. Is it clear? That what we will do is, we will break it up into two sub-problems. The first one, where the stamp is there. The second one, where this stamp is not there. So if L is the list of stamps, L1 to LN, in L and C, if L is null or C is 0, you return 0. If C becomes less than 0, you return infinity, saying that this is not a feasible solution. Otherwise, you break it up into two parts, L1 and C minus 1, and L1 and C. L1 is what? The list after removal of the first element. The list after removal of the first element. So either it is included or not included. Is that clear? Is everybody okay with this? Good. Now, once we have this, how are we going to solve it? How do we solve our current stamps or coin problem? Do we run some program? When we have to give coins to somebody, how do we solve it? This is a very interesting problem. Because depending on the problem, there are different methods to use. Yeah, so minimum, how do you get that minimum? If I take the highest, then second highest, third highest, I will get the solution. That is all right. So that is everything is written here. When will you get the solution that way? Use the highest, second highest, third highest. In our normal coins, you take any value. Our coinage system is such that you take the highest as many, then the second highest, it will give you minimum. You think you have to make any, some 75 paisa you have to make, you take 50, 25. You have to take 65, you take 50, 10, 5. So if the property is that, is it true for everything, every number? Yes or no? For what is this not true? No, there must be examples where Simply taking the largest, next largest, next largest will not give you. Just make that example, you will see. So if you take 6, then you have to take 1, 1, you'll require 3. But if you take 2 4s, you'll get done in 2. And the coinage was 1, 4, and 6, and you were asked to make 8. But that is not how our coinage system is defined. It's very interesting. So, if it is part of our coinage system, then what does this reduce to? Then what do we call this algorithm? What do we do? From L, we take out the largest and run it on that one only. So it becomes a greedy method. Depending on the property of the problem, it becomes a greedy method. Got it? It becomes a greedy scheme. But if the property of the problem is such that it is the case like the example she pointed out, that is not true, then you have to run this algorithm. So what is the next thing that you will look for? When you open up this recursion, what is the next thing that you will look for? Yes. That we are going to come to, but before that, can there be identical subproblems? There can be. There can definitely be identical subproblems here. So if there are to be identical subproblems, then what is it that you will have to remember? L and C. You will have to remember L and C. You'll have to remember L and C, the list L and C. And the list L can be remembered by its size if you always choose the first element out like we have done here. The list L can be remembered only by its size if you always choose the first element out. But if you don't choose the first element out, then you have to remember that set. So there is a trade-off. There is a trade-off if you want to dynamically decide. Here we have decided on L1, but you could choose any of the LIs. It does not matter. So if I have to memorize, then I have to memorize this. What is the third property of this algorithm? It is minimum. So everything need not be evaluated. Everything need not be evaluated. Correct? So let us see how that happens. This is a depth first evaluation of the same recursive definition. This is a depth-first evaluation of the same recursive definition. What do? We keep a best cost that we have obtained till now as infinity, because whatever solution we get, it is min. Min is a associative and a commutative operator. So I can do in any order I want, I don't care. Initially the solution is null. L is the list of available stamps, C is the cost to be met, S is the current set of stamps chosen, and N is the number of stamps chosen. And I am trying to minimize N. Correct? So here again, if L is null or C is zero, which means we have reached the this condition. We have reached this condition. Who is taking toll of you, the lunch or the class? None. So if this is it, then you have reached the leaf node. And if you have reached the leaf node, then your solution lies in S, the current set of stamps chosen. And the number of stamps chosen till now is N. So then you check if N is less than the best cost done till now. Because you are doing minimization across all the leaf nodes. Just remember this structure. This blue, one we found, the next one, we are taking it in that order. So if N is, so here means you have gone to a leaf node. You have gone to a leaf node. And you will check whatever is the best solution till now. So the first solution will be assigned as the best solution is N, and the solution will be stored as S. So if you reach a leaf node, this is what you will do. Otherwise, if C is less than 0, which means this condition, from here no solution is possible. So what will you do? Get out from here. So you will return, which is equivalent to backtracking. Then you will do what the recursion says. L1 is this, you will call stamps and stamps twice. You could do it in any order, it does not matter. But it may matter for the algorithm to do it in a particular order. So just go through this and convince yourself that this is a simple depth first backtracking based traversal which finds the solution, uses the associative property of min, and like a good student follows that recursive definition. Here I am finding the minimum. If N is less than the best cost is made N. As soon as I reach the leaf, this is the leaf node. If L is null or C is 0, that is the leaf node. So as soon as I reach the leaf node, if L is 0, null or C is 0, I check the value of N. Because that is when I have got the solution. And I compare it with the best cost. So this is where I am doing the min. This is where I am doing the min. All right? Are you okay? This is where I am backtracking on this condition. If C is less than 0, it becomes infinity. And then these two recursive conditions I am putting here. L1 is L minus that first element removed. So I remove L1 from cost, I add it to the solution set and I increase N. And if I don't take it, I leave it like this. So the first one is taking it, the second one is not taking it. So I have invoked backtracking. I have found the best solution, because whenever I find the solution, I take a min. And because it is associative, I can take the min across solutions like here. I can use this operator. I can use this principle. I can use this principle here. First one, then the second one, then the third one, then the fourth one. No, not yet. And so on. Are you getting it? Yes or no? Good. Now here, I could do something more, which I have done in the next slide. And just look at what I have done there. I am in the middle of my, I have not reached a leaf node. I have not reached a leaf node. I am somewhere in the middle of my search. But the number of stamps that I have already taken is more than the best solution or equal to the best solution. So is there any need for me to continue from here? So this is the pruning condition of branch and bound. Correct? And remember, instead of doing it here, I could have done it up here also. I did it there for us to show you that it is not a leaf node, it is in the middle of somewhere. It is not a leaf node, it is not a backtracking node, but I can move out. And if I can move out this way, then this is called pruning by branch and bound. Branch means this branching, and this bound, I have found that N is already not going to give me a solution which is going to be better than the best solution I have already obtained. So there is no point for me to continue further. How can I improve this? Can you do something better? Anything better? Yeah, that's what I said. We can put this up here, or before calling this, we can put this and all that we can do. We can put this pruning condition right in the beginning, right up here. Or you can check it before calling this one, whatever. That is all right. Anything better? Suppose I have got N. Currently, I have got an N. And the best solution is B. And the largest stamp that I have available, I ordered the stamps that I have available in order of size, value. And I go on taking some of them till it crosses the remaining C amount. And I count them. I add it to N. And if that is greater than or equal to the best solution till now, I don't need to go anymore. That is the bound. That is finding the bound. Why? Why will it be better? Then you can take all stamps at a time, it should be better. No, it will not happen that way. Because the two of them may not give you a solution, but this one and something else will give you a solution. We are doing no look ahead. There is no look ahead here. This is a look at this. This is a little worse than what I just told you, but this also you can get. You find the largest one, you see how many more such are there to cover the remaining stamp. So this is called the bound. The more accurate you make the bound, the more pruning will occur. This is the theory of bound, branch and bound. The theory of branch and bound says that the more pruning you, the more accurate you make the bound, the more pruning will occur. It's obvious. Are you following? Yes or no? This is yes or no? You are all teachers, you know. Yeah, everybody knows that looking at the student, you can make out whether they are understanding or not. And the most difficult thing for a teacher is to continue teaching when nobody is understanding anything. You have to finish the syllabus. And we did this as depth first. Now, here, nobody told us we have to do this before this. We could do it in any other order. We could do it in a dynamic order. So when you try to do it in a dynamic order, what is it called? What branch and bound? It is called best first branch and bound. So what is the difference between depth first branch and bound and best first branch and bound? You remember we said that we initially start with fx and then generate the children, remove this, generate the children, and then put the children in x in this list. Now if we take them out and use this list as a queue, then it becomes depth first. As a stack, it becomes depth first. But we could put it into that list and start removing those elements whose, in this case, whose n is smallest. Here, we will put that in a stack. If we do depth first, fixed order, it is like putting it in a stack and removing from the stack. But we could put it into the list, the children. So we remove a node, put the children into the list. And then again when we remove that node whose n value is the smallest. Or this n plus whatever new value we got, that bounded value is the smallest. So that leads us to the algorithm called best first branch and bound. If you use it as a stack and the standard algorithm with the pruning that we showed here, it is depth first branch and bound. On the other hand, if you remove the best possible node and you go through this in details, then it is called the best first branch and bound. In addition, what else can we remember? As we just said, identical subproblems. That means, if there are two nodes, if you create a new node which already is there in L or has been seen before, you don't need to use this node anymore unless certain property, unless you come with a smaller n. The L and C will be same. The only reason where this new node can be kept, so if there are two duplicate nodes, you will only keep the one whose n is smaller. And you will throw it out. So a combination of dynamic programming, depth first or breadth first, other search, and pruning, all of them together will end up to this algorithm. On the other hand, if it is like our coinage system, then a simple greedy algorithm will work. So the final version of the algorithm will depend on exactly all the parameters put together. Optimal common subsequence, you can have a look in the book. It's very standard. There is a well-known recursive definition. All you need to do there is the book will give you the bottom-up algorithm. You remember we did this top-down algorithm with memorization? Just use that. And it's very simple. So if you are still interested in coding, you can just write the code, it will work. And you'll be convinced yourself that you don't need to write that iterative loop or anything. It'll simply work that way. Kruskal's, Prim's algorithm, both can be derived. We did one of them just now in the morning, remember? We showed how that min can be put inside for greedy. So let us, as an exercise, look at the shortest path in a graph. So again, I have only one mantra, write a recursive definition. So suppose my function is SP, shortest path. What will be the arguments? Source and destination are all global. The current tip node, the current node, you'll call it with S, and then along the edges you'll move. So you are always looking at some path. So the current node from where you have to go to the goal. So you'll need a node S, or you'll need a node N, and you'll call it with S. What else? Weight of the? Not edge. Weight of the cost from start to coming to this node N. Weight of the cost of coming from start to this node N. These are the two arguments you need. The rest can be all global. Correct? So let us try. All this I will do now. In the main workshop, difficult problems you all will do from there. Huh? I have written the basis condition that if N is the goal node, then C is the cost. If you want to store the path also? Or no? Let's forget it for the time being. You can always add the path. And we will call it with SP start 0. Correct? This is how we will call it. So what is the recursive condition? SP NI C plus Done? Is everybody okay with this definition? Write it down, because I'll take this page out and do something else. And then if you forget, then it's a problem. Is this definition clear to everybody? Now, when we implement this algorithm, we can now, if we have to memorize, what will we memorize? N and cost. Which node you are in, and what is the cost from start to that node? That's all you have to memorize. Identical subproblem means you have come to this node with another cost, or same cost, or whatever. So the node N is what you have to memorize, and you have to remember the cost. So that is what you are going to maintain, the node N and the cost. If we require dynamic programming, why? Because if I traverse this way and I come back this way, I will come to this node with another cost. And if the new cost is more, then I don't need to do anything. If the new cost is less, then I need to remove this and move with this one. So now I have got these two options of doing depth first or breadth first, best first, or whatever. So now to solve this, I'm not going to tell you all the details, but if you can apply depth first branch and bound like we did before, and if you apply best first branch and bound, what will you do? That list L will initially contain node 1 with cost 0. Look at it very carefully. Okay. Then I will remove this, and the list L will contain what? Node 2 with cost, and node 3 with cost. Now, which one will I take out? I could take anyone out, doesn't matter. It depends on which order I have. If I do depth first, then which order I have put, I have to take out in that order. But now, in best first, which will I want to take out first? This one. And the list will now become 3, 4. 4, 1, 4, 4. Look at the definition, C plus cost. 3 plus 1, so 4, 4. And 3, 7 will want to go in, and immediately you will detect that this is an identical subproblem. So 3, 7 will want to go in, but it will get thrown out because of identical subproblem. Next, which one we'll take out? Anyone, it does not matter. So we can take 3-4 out or 4-4 out. You want to take 3-4 out? Then what else you will get? Original 4-4 was there. Now 4-5 will want to come in. That 4-5 will want to come in. And this will be removed because of identical subproblem. All right. Next, I will remove this one and not this one. I am following the best first branch and bound principle. So I'll remove this, and what will come? And then which one I will remove? No, I'll remove this. And this condition will now get satisfied? Yeah, as soon as this comes in, we'll remove this. And now we'll remove this and we have found the solution. And if you look at it very, very carefully, this is exactly what Dijkstra's algorithm does. It finds out from that list the node with minimum value, then it does that push relaxation step, which is generating the children, path relaxation step, which generates the children, and it maintains global values for every node. Therefore, this 5-5-5-10, it removes the identical subproblems. As soon as you come with a smaller value, it updates that value. That is what it does in that relaxation step. So if you observe and do a step-by-step of what Dijkstra's algorithm does, then you'll observe that it does best first branch and bound with identical subproblem recognition. So all these algorithms, as I just said, you can have a quick look at them, and the methodologies that we have discussed after the recursive definition, analysis, looking at the tree, traversal of the tree, identification of identical subproblems, and memorization. That is all that is there. If you use all these in a systematic manner, you will end up with your final algorithm. There are several others: all pair, shortest path, max flow, traveling salesman. Do them. I will come and ask. These are all in the textbook. But just look back at them in the same light. And then I will show you that some of the algorithms, like the matrix chain multiplication, the dynamic programming algorithm, if you look at the matrix chain multiplication problem, this one, there is a minimum here. Nobody applies branch and bound here. Nobody applies. But we have applied it and found that it actually, if you combine dynamic, this top-down algorithm that we have, and if you put in branch and bound there, you get a dramatic reduction compared to the standard algorithm that you get. Very simple problem. That is why this top-down algorithm is important. Because in this algorithm, you can put in the pruning condition. You can put in the pruning condition here, just like you put it in the stamps problem. You'll just check whether the value here that you have obtained till now is better than the best solution of that node. It's a little tricky, but you can do it. And this Dijkstra's shortest path algorithm with all its browns and other things, has another fancy name. The AI people have copied all algorithms and put new names. It's called the algorithm A star. If you look at it, it is nothing but a variation of Dijkstra's algorithm. There is a reason for it. The variation comes from the following fact, that in today's scenarios, when the graph is very large, then all of the graph cannot be stored in the main storage. So you now have additional cost of bringing the graph. So you want to keep only a minimum portion of the graph and you want to bring in the rest of it. So those issues we'll discuss later, because this is, as we said, we are talking about the first course. But when modern things come up, you have to do spanning tree of 20 million node graph, you cannot store the graph. What will you do? You have to find shortest path, the graph is on the hard disk. Now you are laughing, but this is very important. These are modern day questions. These are the, if you really try to solve the Google Maps problem, you just see, try to run Dijkstra's shortest path algorithm. Your computer will start making a sound, katakat, 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 katakat. You know what that sound is? We got used to it. As soon as we are in the old computer days, so there wasn't enough main memory. Nowadays it happens less. Sound is also less. As soon as it starts accessing the disk main memory, there is failure. So it goes to the disk and starts accessing it. So as soon as that access increases, then the sound of the algorithm, you know, the algorithms have sound also. Katakat, 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 katakat. You know, you hear of thrashing. You can hear thrashing. So nowadays, these algorithms, you try to implement Google Maps, is not so straightforward. I will give you a map of 20 million nodes. What will you do? You will first not be able to declare the array itself. Your C program will throw its hands up, 20 million node array. And then you'll start realizing the difference between n squared and n log n and n when it comes there. Good, thank you very much. Yeah, yeah. Best first search, DFS. In DFS, if the height of the tree, just listen 1 minute, chai is ready, I know. No, he has asked a very interesting question. The question is that what is the memory requirement of DFS vis-a-vis best first search? So if the height of the tree is fixed, known. For example, in these problems, the height of the tree is the number of nodes. Then, this is the memory requirement, the length of the longest path in the recursion tree. But in BFS, you can require the full space. So the memory requirement will be more, but the pruning will be more. As I said, the space-time trade-off is very interesting. And there are methods which improve it. There is a method called iterative deepening. You do DFS level 1, you don't get a solution. You do level 2, you don't get a solution. You do DFS level 3. So you save on memory, you do it multiple times, but you do it in less memory. So there are other tricks which you can do. No. Suppose there are 5 such solutions, right? This is a for loop. This is a minimum taken from k to I to j minus 1. All of them are not necessary. It's a minimum problem. In a minimum problem, all of them need not be necessary. If you have two, three options, it's a minimum problem. You get one and you find a bound for this is better than, is worse than this, then you don't need to do it. Thank you.